It's only 2 weeks left to the regular season.
It's over.
And that's
finally.
That's it. That is
thank
it.
God.
Yeah, thank fucking
God. We've had to
God.
Endure a lot.
Thank fucking God. Okay. Five.
Four.
Three.
Two.
And one.
Hello world, hear the song that we're singing. Come on, get happy.
Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames, messieurs, bienvenue, welcome to the Habby Hour.
Welcome back, Habs listeners. Habby Hour listeners, even. Habs watchers. Where, you know, you might be tuning into the Habby Hour once it's recorded and finished after this historic loss against the Minnesota Wild.
Is it historic?
No.
Oh, okay.
It was a bygone conclusion. Jesus Christ, this team. So far, the Habs have won two games in the month of April.
Two. Oh, shit.
Two. And they've played more than two, actually.
Mm-hmm.
If people have been paying attention. We'll talk about that and many other things. Many other things that have been chronic issues with the Habs in the past. I still take extreme prejudice against. I'm a broken record. I'm going to continue to be broken until it's fixed. That's the only way I can look at it. Before we get into that, I want to say something not hockey related. My mother, last week, finished her last treatment of radiation. I haven't mentioned anything about this. My mother was diagnosed with stage 2 breast cancer in the fall, last fall. Went through chemo. And as mentioned, chemo came back. Well, not chemo, but after the chemo treatments, things looked great. So, of course, the next logical step is to do radiation to pinpoint it. Give her a, you know, a sunburn for a while, you know, where they're pinpointing it. She did that. And now, after another checkup or two in the next 2 months, the prognosis that we are hoping for, that everyone is saying, is that everything is good. Cancer eliminated. And my mom's fine. So,
amazing. Amazing.
It is
wonderful
amazing.
News.
It is wonderful news. I'm overjoyed to report it. In the past, I've been wearing the purple Hockey Fights Cancer Habs hat. There was a reason to that, and that's what it was. Throughout the entire process, my mom, though, as crazy as she is, continued working. No problem. She's a trooper. Doesn't know when to quit. Doesn't matter if there's a malignant mass of tissue within her body trying to kill her at the same time. This being the second malignant mass of tissue within her body after me.
David.
Even though this was many, 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 many years ago during the the heyday of the Cold War. Now then. My name is David
O'Jay.
That's
fantastic news.
What? Yes, it is. It is fantastic news. It's very good news. And I, didn't really share it all that much. But now that things are okay, I felt to share it because it's good news. No need to dwell on it any longer. My mother is now more than happy to go back to casinos in Las Vegas and drink herself silly and gamble away what estate I could inherit from her, which will be nothing. Thank you, mother. My name is David OJ. I'm at MetalDave02 on Twitter.com, joined as always by Veronica.
Yeah, I'm at CHI. Oh, I am a candidate for Prime Minister of Canada.
Ooh.
And my at is CHILE underscore pepper on Twitter.com.
Now, refresh my history. Has there ever been a female Prime Minister of Canada?
Yes.
Okay.
She was, I forget what her, she was like interim Prime Minister, Kim Campbell.
Oh.
She was kind of a disaster.
Mm.
And this was in, I want to say, the early 90s.
No kidding.
And she stepped in, and I don't remember why, but she also did kind of like a, do you remember on the cover of Vanity Fair, Demi Moore, when she was pregnant with her first baby?
Oh, okay.
The nude shot.
Ooh, Demi Moore?
You know?
I'll check this out later. I'm very interested now.
So it was kind of a, so she did kind of a nude shot, like with a prime minister robe in front of her, but like, you know, bare shoulders and stuff like that. And, you know, she was completely discredited as a silly woman and everything like that. She was only for a brief time prime minister, but she was not elected.
Oh, so it's kind of like, so it's kind of like if Biden did like a shoot in Vogue.
Yeah.
En Vogue.
Yeah.
We would have been like, didn't really anticipate this side of Joseph Biden.
Kim Campbell.
Campbell. So,
but she's the only one. But the reason that I joke about being candidate for Prime Minister of Canada is because that guy, Pierre Poilievre. He's the guy who's like, he's basically, you know, a student of U.S. Republican politicians. And he's just like, he's that guy that was like supporting those
the so-called truckers. The freedom convoy.
Yes.
Because there isn't enough freedom to be had.
Yeah. He's never denounced all of these criminals that are being charged with everything, by the way.
Yeah. Like, doesn't look good.
That's on his Twitter account. And so if you like Google, not Google, but if you do a Twitter search for candidate for Prime Minister of Canada,
everybody's
there are a lot of people.
It's going to be a tight race.
Have that on their profile.
It's going to be a tight race. Let's see. So aside from that, look south of the border down in the States. One of the heads of the Proud Boys flipped. And people's heads are rolling from the January 6th insurrection, stuff that happened back then. So we will see how all that turns out. Now, with all that being said, we are the Habby Hour at Habby Hour on Twitter.com, Habby Hour Pod on Instagram, HabbyHour.com and YouTube.com/Habby Hour to watch us live. Well, sort of live. At some point, we should do a live show. It will be a disaster, but we should It would be a complete disaster.
Nothing different than what we usually do.
Yeah, nothing all that much different. Speaking of disasters, the Habs lost, got shut out again. And as many times as Carey Price has started games for the Habs. Now, of course, Twitter is alit currently. Ce soir, parce que... Le dernier marqué pour les Canadiens was during the fucking Stanley Cup Finals in overtime game 4. That was the last time the Habs scored a goal with Carey Price in net. It's a resounding embarrassment. I don't care if we're trying to judge young talent. I don't care who the opponent is. This is Carey Price, the current face of the franchise. Like, as it stands right now, he is the face of the franchise, and the Habs cannot get it done in front of him. I hate to use the phrase, not being able to rise to the occasion, but holy fuck, score a goal!
Yeah.
Habs got thumped 8-4 against the Capitals over the weekend. And is it the Coliseum today? Don's the Coliseum was talking about how Carey let down the team tonight.
Dans les coulisses.
Yeah. Was that them? I have to double check now because
that's their name, isn't it?
Nope. I'm so sorry. Sorry. It was Le Journal de Montréal. Okay. Never mind.
Oh, God.
Much less reputable. Carey Price ne fait pas le poids face au Wild. Essentially blaming Carey for not being ready against the Wild. And it's like, bro, or Brett, Broette, yeah, lady, or whatever in between. Montembeau let in more goals in one game than Carey Price has let in this entire season.
Yeah.
Like, fuck off. This team is shambles. It drives me nuts. And the broken record thing that I talk about so many times. What the fuck is Alex Burrows doing? I don't know what his job is anymore. 3 power plays tonight. 3 shots on those power plays. Thank God they got shots on goal. However, man, during the first period, it was the second power play of the game. And in the first period, Cole Caulfield, love him. He is another, he is going to be a star for the Habs for many, many years. He has the puck, not quite on the point, not quite down in the mid wall by the hash marks on the circle there. But he makes an attempt to pass it back to the defenseman on the point 2 times. And both times, there was a Minnesota Wild player there nabs the puck, and gets a breakaway on twice. It happened literally within the span of 30 seconds. Two times. It's the fucking power play. What is going on? What is happening? I just don't know. I do not know. And I would be shocked if Alex Burrows is back next season. As crazy as it is that we have this freaking carousel of assistant coaches that go in and their job is this is going to be the guy to fix the power play. It never fucking happens. Kid played with the Sedins? Well, we should have brought in both of the fucking Sedins then. Because Alex Burrows is Sedin light with the Canucks. He didn't do the fucking power play with the Sedins. Fuck.
And what's going on? Like when Martin St-Louis took over, he kind of said, you know, I'm just going to trust them to trust their instincts and you know, play loose out there. And is that what's going on here?
That has to be it. Because you want to know another thing too. There was a game. Oh God, I'm trying to think. It may have been the game against the Caps that Romanov had just an awful game. It was either against the Caps or against. Let's see, where was the schedule here? I had it. I don't think it was the Islanders. It may have been the Caps. Might have been the Jackets last week too. Because I mean, the Habs had just been getting flummoxed.
Yeah.
Killed in the past week. Yeah. Regardless, Romanov has a few not great plays. Not his best game, essentially. He wasn't sat. He wasn't benched. Jordan Harris. And guys, am I right there? Yeah. Jordan Harris makes more than his fair share of mistakes in the game. Not benched. No one's getting benched. Everyone's playing. There are a lot of time that they want him to play. And it has to be, I have to believe, part of St. Louis, you know, strategy going forward. It's a lost season. Why bench people? Yeah. You know, during a lost season, you only replace somebody if they're injured. Like Paul Byron today is injured again, so he was out for the rest of the game there.
Was he injured again? Did he start today?
He started today, but then he left during the first period.
I missed most of the game today. So I saw part of the first. That's it.
So like that's also to say that the Habs had to play with a man down on offense. And it's also to say that the Wild are a damn good team, because that first period was a rough display of that. Given that the Habs were just, again, not playing very well.
All that I saw was giveaway after giveaway after giveaway.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Constantly. Nick Suzuki, the running narrative at the moment is that he's playing hurt because he's never at practice, practically. Right. Anytime that we hear about, you know, tweets or news in the morning on any given day is that he's taking a therapy day. And I really wonder, does he have enough PTO to do that? Do they have PTO? Is there like an agreed upon amount of therapy days you can take during a season? No idea. I'd love to figure that out, though. But I am not reading the NHLPA about it.
No.
Not worth the time.
No.
But yeah, it's just without saying, even though we've been saying it for the past few minutes of recording here, Habs have not been doing well. Let's see. 2-0.
Was today 5 in a row that they lost?
Yes. In regulation as well.
Yeah.
I wonder when the last time that's happened. Must have been a lot during this season. Ha ha. The last win was against Toronto 2 weekends ago. Which is, that's fine, honestly. And then the last win before that was the overtime win against Tampa Bay Lightning. The shootout win that Nick Suzuki got a darling of a goal in.
Oh, beautiful.
Yep. Oh, I'm so sorry. No. I am actually, nope. I'm fucking up. 2 weeks ago, Toronto won that game. I meant to say the last game that the Habs won was that 7-4 flubbing of the New Jersey Devils in Jersey.
Right.
It's a game I can't even fucking remember.
I don't really. Oh, no, because I didn't watch that one live. That one was a shootout win, wasn't it? No.
No.
I thought it was Jersey. A shootout win against the Devils. I have no idea. It's
against the Bolts.
Right.
Yeah. So April 2nd. Win against the Bolts, April 7th, win against the Devils, and they have not won a game since April 7th.
The Knights lost to the Devils yesterday.
Yeah, I think the Knights, I don't know if they're strictly out of the playoff picture yet, but it's getting to the wire now for them.
Yeah.
So
the only reason I sort of know about this is because Max is paying very close attention because the Canucks are, they're on a roll right now.
Oh, yeah, they're making a run for it.
Yeah.
Good for the Canucks.
They're on a roll, and they're playing with a lot of character.
There it is. I need, like, I
and
just
they're
need...
they're down their captain right now, too, so they're playing with a lot of character. So it's kind of... It's wow. exciting. Max is upstairs right now watching the game.
Who would have thought playing with character, character? Who would have thought that would be an important component in a hockey team? Strange. Very strange. So here we are.
So here we are.
Let me see. Yeah, the games in the past week almost can't, they're not even all that memorable. Last one was Jesus. Yeah, as I said, against the Devils. Game against the Maple Leafs, 3-2 loss, whatever. Yeah, Matthews scores two. Oh, yeah, the whole conversation about Matthews 50-50. And it's like as if I want to quote Ellen Ripley from Alien, Sigourney Weaver in this, and saying, did IQs just drop off rapidly while I wasn't on Twitter? Because though Matthews, 50 goal scorer, great accomplishment. Don't give a fuck about that rat ass bastard. 50-50 is scoring 50 goals within the first 50 games of the team's season. That's it. That's it. That is it.
Yeah.
There's no other way to interpret that.
No.
Any other way to interpret it is that, yeah, he got 50 goals within the season. Done. He did it within 62 or 67 games or something like that. Yeah, that is great, but it's not 50-50.
No.
Like, that's it. And Leafs Twitter was painting it as, like, the gold standard. That's how you do it. And no, it isn't. It isn't. It's never been that way.
Whatever. They have revisionist history about everything, right? Just to somehow make themselves feel better about the fact that their team doesn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
When it matters, right?
That's right.
I've maintained I do not fucking care. I do not fucking care about individual awards. I don't fucking care about, you know, points in a season. All I care about is making the playoffs.
Yeah, all I care about
is... It's not a goal.
Yep.
But it's important.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the only goal, obviously. But you got to make the playoffs, right?
Yes, so, you do.
And then when you get to the playoffs, you got to do something in the playoffs. And so it's been almost 20 years now that they've been incapable of doing anything like that. And I don't see how they're, just like last year, I don't care what kind of season they've had. I don't see how they're going to, I don't know if there's any character on that team. I don't know if they've got any heart. I haven't watched them much this season, but, and also you need a good goalie.
It was the shock of my life. Literally the shock of my life, my entire life, shocked when they did not make a play for a goalie at the trade deadline. Like that is the issue with the, if they actually had a goalie, they might actually have a shot, but I don't think so. I was speaking to my, some of my hockey compatriots at Hooters last week, you know, a refined establishment with incredible beer and great wings and fries.
Nice. No.
One of our guys was leaving, is leaving the team and moving someplace. So we had to give him a go away party? What the fuck do they call those now?
Going away party.
Going away. I would like the go away party. I'm like, no, that sounds too weird. Will you go, please? The going away party. All right, now I got now I finally have the episode name that I wanted, the go away party. All right, that's good. All right, so we're having a go away party for Bobby. And, We got to the topic of the playoffs, and it was unanimous with a table of like around a dozen, you know, fellow hockey people of completely different fandoms. And everyone was like, there's no way they're getting out of the first round because they didn't get a goalie.
Tale as old as time. Agreed. And it's not just that they don't have any heart.
Nope. Zero. Done.
Zero.
Man. Yep. Loss against, like, Blue Jackets.
You know, it's, I mean, we've beat this dead horse how many times, but
oh, this horse is a corpse at this point. Yeah. It is a bloody pulp seeping into the ground, making it.
It's not
nutrients.
Baseball.
Yeah.
You can't just get a bunch of guys that can score and go, hey, go, woohoo, we're going to win the cup every year. No. Mm-mm-mm-mm.
Yeah, spend 3.5 hours watching baseball. Greatest time of my life.
Oof.
Rather freaking. Man, what a fucking game that was against the Islanders. So the biggest news, honestly, the biggest news for the Habs is that Price is back. And not only that, but Price looks normal. He does. Calm. Moves the way he moves. It was mentioned during the podcast, during the broadcast today with Dan Robertson and Mike Johnson.
Yeah.
Which was a great treat because I didn't expect that.
Wearing matching suits
because they're just a bunch of dudes being bros. The opening faceoff of the game, the puck goes deep into the Habs zone, just right off the rip. Teams are chasing after it. And Price, you know, just herpy-derp, goes around the net as he does, stops the puck with his stick like it's nothing. Like he's breathing air. But the thing is, this puck is rattling around the boards and he just, you know, poke checks the puck to the ground. He has two Islanders, you know, blocking the boards for any sort of like bank off it that one would assume that a goalie would do. No, what he does is that he passes the puck straight up the middle to the only open Hab out there in the middle. Guy grabs it, curls around, and breaks out of the zone. And that's it. You know, any other goalie probably would have, you know, hesitated a second, and who knows what would have happened then. But it's Carey Price we're talking about. And he looked fine. He looked fine against the Islanders. In the game against the Islanders, it was nothing for two periods until, then it was Zach Parise opens the scoring. You know, it was 1-0. And then in that third period, a 0-0 game became a 3-0 game against the Habs. And we're thinking, oh, how typical. Habs can't score with Price in net. I was hoping it would be a different thing tonight, but it happened again, despite the goal that was called back.
Yeah, but how, like, they were, like, handily outshooting the Islanders. Like, crazy.
Oh, yeah. Shots at the end of the match were 44-20. But it's also, I didn't like how they were playing in so far that, they were getting tons of shots against the Islanders. However, Sorokin, he didn't have to do a whole lot to make those saves either. You know what I mean? It's just, it's as if the high danger chances, when one says that, you're talking about shots in the slot, which is between the two face-off dots. You know, things that are give the shooter more advantage, give him more angles. We're taking shots from, like, the fucking concession stands. It's like, of course Sorokin's going to stop those. Habs were 0-2 on the power play. Jesus Christ, Habs were 0-2 on the power play against the Capitals. Habs were 0-3 on the power play against the Wild tonight. I'm sure I can go back further into the recent history of games here and see how the power play was. Like against New Jersey, you know, the Habs scored 7, and they weren't even given a power play opportunity in that game. Mm-hmm. Strange. When's the last time the Habs scored? Oh, yeah, 4 power plays against the Leafs. Didn't score on any of them. 1 power play against Columbus, didn't score. I lied, against Winnipeg. So I think the last time that the Habs scored a power play goal was April 13th. Against the Blue Jackets.
Right.
Which would give them a horrendous record of power play, you know, success since that date. Like, it's below 10%. It's just what I do not understand. You have a Caulfield, you have a Suzuki, you have Romanov, you have Harris. Well, Harris is kind of learning, but it's just, I don't know.
Holy shit, do they cover Caulfield though, eh? The other teams?
Oh, they know
they
now.
They do not want him to get the puck.
They do know. They do know now. Yeah. So there is that at least.
Yep. I mean, with, you know, sort of the imprint that Gorton and Hughes are making on this team, I would really be shocked if Alex Burrows kept his job, at least as the power play coach.
Right. Yeah, it's
It is really astonishing how historically bad the Habs have been on the power play, like spanning over a decade.
Over a decade. Absolutely over a decade.
Yeah.
Ever since I started watching, it's like, wow, power play is coming. Sweet. We're going to get a goal. Okay, maybe next time. Okay. Maybe we'll get a goal against. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's so bad. It's so bad.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh my God.
Like, now, nobody's making a very big deal out of it. And the other night too, with the 8-4 loss against the Capitals, apparently the coach Martin St-Louis after the game, like, I guess he was being questioned about leaving Montembeau in net for the whole game. Mm-hmm. And I mean,
well, his whole thought was that he didn't want to put Price in.
Yeah, you don't want to put Price in
because of the back-to-back.
Yeah,
Montembeau's the backup. He gets the shit rolls downhill. There it is.
Yeah,
that was a shit ton of rubber. So
it's like when Michel Therrien got vilified for leaving in Al
Montoya
against Montoya.
Was it the Blue Jackets?
The Blue Jackets.
Yeah,
10-1.
Mm-hmm. I think that was a weekend where the Habs got killed, like, in a similar fashion too. It was like 8-0, then 10-0. Like, the Blue Jackets just murdered the Habs that weekend. Yeah, that was a bad
one. Columbus, the Cannon.
Yeah, that was a bad one. What else was more to that? Now, granted, the Capitals, however, have historic success in the Bell Center. In the past few, I forget the exact number, but I feel like it's since 2017, the Caps are 17-1-2 in the Bell Center.
Wow.
Yeah. So whenever the Caps are in town, don't go to the game. The Habs will lose. They will lose. I believe in streaks. And this one is a big one. Might be the biggest one.
Yeah, because it's in the players' heads too, definitely.
Mm-hmm. I wonder. Actually, well, they probably don't keep track of streaks like that, frankly. That's like,
well, you know, the players stuff, will. The players kept track of the losing streak in San Jose. They knew damn well.
Well, I wonder if it's like, do they know or do they like, oh, really? That's crazy. Because whoever's interviewing them brings it up and they're like, oh, really? That's crazy. Ha ha ha. Hopefully we win this time. 20 years later.
Yeah, I recall something. I think Josh Anderson said something about it. Like, he knew. It was brought up to him, but he knew exactly what they were talking about.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Now, further to that point, something important that I wanted to talk about is during one of the pressers it might have been after the Islanders, the loss, and they're interviewing Carey Price. Now, Carey Price can actually do interviews now, which is great post-game.
Yeah.
And he had mentioned how he's still dealing with the Stanley Cup loss. And I'm like, that is also a big indicator for Shea Weber. Isn't it? I can only imagine. Which that might be the biggest question mark of all now for the Habs is what's going to happen with Shea Weber. Is he going the Carey Price route and just taking time off to deal with himself because of the Stanley Cup loss, because of physical issues? Who knows? Because we have heard zero about Shea Weber in a long time.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah. We've heard a lot of speculation and a lot of people who seem to be owners of the truth. But like, there's just little things like Kent Hughes, Gorton talking about naming the next captain and that kind of thing. Like, kind of like Shea Weber is just like not in the picture for them anymore. There's that kind of thing. But I actually was thinking about that the other day. Thinking about Shea Weber in Game 5 in Tampa and that Stanley Cup final. And just like, how do you recover from that? Your entire career, you've been trying to get there and you're finally there.
Had to
seconds left, and they could have tied it.
There it is. It's always rising to the occasion when you need to.
Yeah.
And here we are. Was Arturi Lehkonen even in the game today against the Habs?
He plays on Colorado.
That's a good point. That's probably why I didn't hear about him.
Yeah. I haven't been paying attention to anything about him the other day, but I was skimming through the NHL app the other day for Max, looking something up for Max, and saw that Colorado beat, I forget what team, like by a, like 8-0, a huge margin. And I went to see his numbers, and he was a -1 in a game that Colorado scored. And he got like 16 minutes of ice time too. So that's the only thing that I've seen about Arturi Lehkonen since he left.
Yeah, well, Arturi's actually playing with legitimate, like, star players now with Colorado.
Yeah.
Those guys that score, team that wins, yada, yada, yada.
Yeah.
So, unfortunately, Lehkonen, I think, was in a completely different country at the time. So, of course, I didn't hear about him. That's my bad.
No problem.
So, there's that. Next game is on Thursday against the Flyers. Assuming Price starts again at home. Let's hope the Habs can actually score a goal.
Yeah.
Give Price some backup.
What were the shots tonight?
I
didn't watch the last two periods.
26-30 against. That wasn't crazy. It was kind of even Steven for a lot of the game too, even though Minnesota like had the play. Though they were making the play, but shots overall were, pretty even. And 30-26, that's nothing. That's nothing in terms of like possession and pressure and just the ability to do stuff. Man.
Yeah.
Yep. Jordan Harris and Jeff Petry killed the last 5 minutes of that game. Puck over glass. Harris is young. Whatever.
What's going on with Jeff Petry? Is he getting traded when we're in Montreal in July?
I don't even know if I can hope for that. Because with how this defensive core is, as it is right now, it's going to take like years for them to be coherent, I think. Jordan Harris, is he going to be a staple up here? Maybe. Caden Gooley, there's a lot of hope for him that he'll be good. Mm-hmm. Don't know if he'll play with the team next year. But it actually brings up another point regarding that. Is, man, this training camp coming up, going to have to bust some fucking balls in there. Holy crap. I'm only saying balls because I'm assuming that all the players on the Habs are equipped as such. You're going to have to run the ringer on them.
Yeah, that'll be interesting to see what Martin St-Louis does.
Exactly, because I don't think he's ever run an NHL training camp before.
Of course not.
No. I really wonder if they're going to get like a... Assuming, because I am assuming that he's going to be their guy next season. Assuming.
Yeah. Ted Hughes is really high on him. He's already kind of let that cat out of the bag that he wants to extend him. So
I'm kind of, I'm wondering if they're going to try to get yet another assistant coach that's maybe perhaps more seasoned in the NHL than Martin. But I really wonder too with that. Clash with what he's trying to do with the team in general. Because I can imagine, assuming again, need a lot of levity here. To say that if Martin's coaching an entire season, he's going to be coaching to win, benching kids, swapping out healthy scratches, trying to get the most optimal team that he can get on the ice to win games.
Yeah.
And that the only reason that things are more... not lackluster, but more not flippant. It's a petri dish right now for Martin. So he's just throwing whatever, sticks to the ice and seeing what happens, I think.
Yeah.
So we'll have to see. So many unknowns going into next season and the off season.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see, a coach with he's got a little bit of NHL experience, but he was brought into a different situation. He just came in to sort of change the mood around the team. And which he did very well. And I think that's what I was saying to you guys last week in the group chat, is that, like, you know, is the shiny penny effect, is that over now with Martin St. Louis? Like, you know, players kind of falling back into their old habits. So yeah, like he was brought into a different situation. So I wonder, like, I'm going to be very interested to see. I'm going to be very curious to see what they do about that situation in management.
Yeah, agreed. Like Le Cavalier, for instance, is he still going to be like
an advisor?
Yeah, like an advisor. Are they going to actually get him in behind the bench? I'm kind of wondering if they're setting this up as an alley-oop to make him closer, you know, to the team, so he's not like a remote video dude or whatever it is that he's doing, the advisor role.
Right.
I'm kind of wondering about that.
I think he wants to live in Florida, though, doesn't he?
Yeah, I have an assumption that he wants to live in sunny Florida.
Yeah.
For the rest of his life.
Yeah.
Or who knows? Maybe he loves, you know, Canada enough and the Montreal Canadiens enough that he actually wants to, you know, move up there and commit to it fully.
Yeah.
Who knows?
I mean, the St. Louis experiment, I think, has been working. But yeah, like, I think he could only benefit from having somebody with, like, actual coaching experience at the NHL level working with him, or some, like, I don't know, man.
Imagine bringing in Therrien as an assistant coach. That'll really whip some freaking people together. Holy
Christ. Oh, God. Can you imagine?
They're soft.
Yeah,
they're
no soft. Idea. So soft.
They're soft. Just smoking right on the bench, blowing it in Caulfield's face.
I think though, like Martin, like his philosophy when he was coming in, like no system, no structure, that kind of thing. I think next year there's going to be some kind of structure implemented.
I think.
Coaching to win, like you
said. I wonder, because the whole concept idea is really skills based. And also too, Habs did hire, they stole that one guy from Toronto to be a strictly skills coach as well. Right. So
yep.
I wonder, I think there is still going to be a bit of leeway with young players, because get this, I was just looking at the time on ice tonight. The player with the most time on ice was Alexander Romanov, 22 minutes. Maxed it out. Second place is Nick Suzuki, followed then by David Savard. And then it was Anderson and Petrie, with Caulfield coming in at like 18 minutes. And then it kind of drops a bit, everyone else. Like even like Edmondson had 17 minutes. That's another thing too. I didn't hear Savard or Edmondson's name at all tonight, nor Romanov's. You know what I mean? So with defense, right, to me, that's always like, well, maybe they're playing okay, but it.
Yeah.
Sometimes it was like a wreck in their own end, as it's been a bit of a consistent issue this entire season. Lowest time on ice with Byron, you know, he had to leave early, followed by Mathieu Perreault, then Dauphin and Pitlick. Pitlick almost got himself a goal, his first goal as a Hab.
Tyler,
called back because Dauphin shoved somebody into the goalie, which I don't know how anybody on Habs Twitter can deny that. It's as plain as day.
Yeah.
Doron shoved the guy in the Talbot. That's it's goaltender interference. That's not a bad call. That's literally happens. But anyway.
I'll bet there were deniers though.
Yeah, I mean, there always are.
Yeah.
Always are. But as soon as I saw the replay, I was like, now that's coming back, unfortunately. If it didn't come back, I would have been like, okay, I guess we're doing this now.
Yeah.
So Mike Hoffman, 100% on the faceoff dot today.
Good for Sweet. Him. Good for how him. Many how many faceoffs did he take?
I wish they actually gave that statistic.
I know, it's crazy.
I fucking hate the NHL website.
It's
so
Yeah, it's stupid. Awful.
So stupid. Hate it. But yeah, that's where we are. Some news to, oh my God, catch up on in the past 2 weeks since we haven't been on. Jonathan Drouin, he's down for the rest of the season. Jesus Christ. Next season, he better bring it. Because either that or he's just going to be
He had the wrist surgery.
Yeah, wrist surgery. So he better bring it, or he's just going to be like a regular dude, I guess, in the Habs, not like a.
He posted to Instagram today, which is rare.
Oh my God, what was it?
It was a photo of him with kids in the loge last weekend. He was hosting a bunch of kids in the, you know, in the whatever, the suite in a suite in the Bell Center.
Oh, well, that's nice.
Yeah.
That is nice. Good for him.
Yeah.
Jesse Ilonen, you know, had a decent running with the Habs, reassigned to the Laval Rocket. The Laval Rocket and Le Lion de Trois-Rivières both heading to the playoffs. So if you want more Habs hockey, be sure to check out the Laval Rocket. And Le Lion, ils ont première saison. That's also the première series, where it'll be their first playoff appearance and their first time being a team in existence. So that's quite an accomplishment. Good for them.
Yeah, it's exciting.
It is exciting. Hopefully. Oh, I wonder how they're going to do the playoffs then this year, because I wouldn't mind trying to catch a game if I can. The last time I saw a playoff AHL game,
yeah,
it was for the Ice Caps, St. John's. They were playing against the Syracuse Crunch, and I went to that game, got a puck, and I also, that was the last game, I think, that the Rock, the Ice Caps had ever played, because after that, they were moved to Laval.
Right.
So I saw their last game, and the last goal against them, it was an overtime goal against them, of course, was scored by their former captain that had been traded to the Lightning. Who the hell was that? Can't remember. I have to look that up. But I'm not.
A listener will know for sure.
It is a name that would be familiar, though, because I do think he played in the NHL for a bit as well. More medical updates. Allen, groin injury. Season is over. Baron kid that we got from.
Yep.
Yeah, he is. His season is also over, but he'll be at training camp. Emil Heinemann, the guy that we got in the. Oh my God, the Foley trade. He's being evaluated in Montreal by medical staff, treated for an upper body injury, and we're not sure if he'll be able to play. Maybe he'll play for the Habs. He's actually under contract, so he could either play for the Rocket or the Habs. So who knows? Maybe we'll get to see this this hotshot prospect that we got in that trade. I'm pretty sure it was the Toffoli one. Yeah, I think it was Toffoli. First inductees announced for the Molson Hall of Fame. Neither myself or Veronica, unfortunately. These both. Oh, they have like rooms dedicated to the Habs. So that's a lot. Good for them. Now, so just some regular Habs fans got to be memorialized as Hall of Fan inductees. Good for them.
That's amazing.
The Radio Teledon raises $182,000 for the Montreal Canadiens Children's Foundation. Awesome time. Saturday night. Let's see. What Saturday was this? This would have been... against the Capitals, it was LGBTQ plus night at the Bell Center. Habs wearing jerseys, repping the LGBTQ plus flag colors. And those jerseys are up for auction. Beautiful jerseys, very colorful.
Yeah, very nice.
Very good for them. We already talked about Carey Price for making his return. Excellent. Michael Pezzetta suspended for 2 games for illegally checking TJ Oshie in the face. Can't do that, apparently. So finally, Georges Perreault has shown his true colors and that he finally suspended a Hab for doing something. He also got billed $7,500.
Damn. Fine, yeah. Georges Paris.
Paris, thank you. Not Perreault. Yeah. Word. tonight was Ivan Cornoyer. Yeah, it was Ivan Cornoyer's night where, if you were one of the first 5,000 fans of the Bell Center, you got yourself a Cornoyer bobblehead. much like the bobblehead I got in the mail of Yvonne Lambert.
I never got mine.
Of the 76-77 Habs. Yeah. You will. Mine took forever to get here, like a month at
okay.
least. Yeah.
We ordered it like fucking, what was it? March. Like a month ago on the air during the podcast.
Yeah, actually. And I only got it like yesterday.
Okay.
And I'm
okay,
in a different country.
Right.
Though I am closer to Montreal.
You are way closer to Montreal than I am.
I am way closer to Montreal than you. But no, it comes in a really nice box. Like the box was so nice, I decided to keep it. And I have the bobblehead right there on my desk. I'm looking
Show
at
us.
Right now. I'm not moving
Can
my
Can you
camera.
Reach it?
Oh, that there's oh yeah. Here comes Yvonne Lambert. Actually, it's a very nice looking bobblehead, though.
Oh, wow.
I do like it quite a bit. So
yeah, he looks great.
Oh, yeah, it looks awesome. Like, compared to their other bobbleheads that they had, like, it actually looks like him, sort of. Yeah. So, good. Nope. Awesome. He is notoriously known in the Habs for scoring the overtime goal of Game 7. Against the Boston Bruins that sent the Habs to the 79 or 78 Stanley Cup playoff game. But that was the overtime game where Don Cherry fucked up. And so Lambert got the winning goal in that in overtime. And beat the Bruins.
Don Cherry can't count.
Don Cherry can't count. Too bad, so sad. But yeah, that's it. So that's what happened. Oh, let's see. How are we doing here? Oh, we got some time left. Don't know what else to talk about. So there are 5 more games left to play. Philly, Senators on Saturday. My friend Chris is going to that one. He's going to...
Are they playing in Ottawa?
Yes, they're playing in Ottawa. So Tim Stützle can, you know, dive all that he wants.
Yeah, yeah.
Boston on Sunday, Rangers on Wednesday, and then next Friday... The last game of the season against the fucking Florida Panthers.
Right.
And that's it. So hopefully the Habs
can't be over soon enough.
Yeah. Hopefully the Habs can win one of those games.
Or score goals.
Or score a goal. Yeah, that'd be nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Goal differential is not in the Habs' favor the past 2 weeks. Let me do some number crunching right here. Okay. The Habs have been outscored.
They have the worst differential in the league.
No. Coyotes they don't? Do now. It now that now belongs solidly to the Coyotes.
I thought the Habs had like in excess of 100.
Nope. That's nope? Coyotes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
3-1-3-7. The Habs have been outgoaled 22-7 in the last since last Monday.
Yeah.
22-7. Gotta do better than that. Don't care who you are. Let me actually take a look at the standings here because I know everyone's really concerned about that first overall pick. So concerned. So much concern. let's see. Oh, tonight the Habs are now -100 while Arizona is -106.
Wow.
Good for them. The next worst team, aside from those two, would be Philadelphia at -85. Just to underscore how bad the Habs have been. The next team has like 15 fewer goals scored against them in the differential race. I don't know how to say that properly. Honestly, I have no idea.
I don't know.
So Habs right now sit at 51 points. They have a game. No, they're 5 games left while Arizona... Who are they playing tonight right now? Arizona? Don't think so. No, whatever. No. Arizona has 6 games left. Habs have 5 games left. Habs have 51 points. Arizona has 49. So people that care, Arizona, of course, could pull ahead at any point that they want to if the Habs lose like every game going forward and blah, 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 blah. Who fucking cares?
Same as it ever was.
Unfortunately, Seattle are likely to finish above the Habs in the standings, despite them being an expansion team. That sucks.
Yeah.
Horrendous.
Just throw away this season.
Awful.
Just throw it away.
Terrible. I'm going to throw it a go-away party.
Throw it a go-away party. Like, honestly, it can't be done soon enough.
Christ. Florida. 11-game win streak. Must be nice. Habs haven't done that since the 70s.
So we're going to be, the Habby Hour is going to be in Montreal in July.
That's right. We will be in Montreal in July for the draft. Myself, Veronica, and Beth. Beth, who, because of scheduling issues, is not here with us tonight. And that's going to continue for a while. It's going to be a little touch and go for when we actually record in a given week. But yes, we will be in Montreal for the draft. And, you want to hang out, get in touch with us. I'm sure we would love the company.
Yeah. We're just scoping out Airbnbs to stay at. Rates at the Airbnb are considerably higher than the last time we were there, David, because I'm sure because of the draft being in Montreal. But it's been like the Airbnb site, not great. Like I say, a house, three people, three guests. And like then these options come up that are like one bedroom.
Oh, no, there's extra filters that you can throw on there to ask for at least three beds. Now, granted, what does bed actually constitute for an Airbnb host? So figure that out. So sometimes I just go for like three bedrooms. But of course, you're asking for three bedrooms. You might as well rent a house at that point. And
we had that apartment last time we were there, and I actually reached out to the Airbnb host because she gave us like a 5-star rating or whatever for being great guests.
Wow, that's kind of surprising given things that occurred.
when the three of us were there, you and Beth and I.
Oh, that one. Never that mind. One. Okay. I was thinking a previous time.
Yeah. No, you and Beth and me.
Right.
That was a three bedroom.
Yeah, that was really good
too. I loved that location. It was just very far from the metro and it was fucking cold when we were there. Holy shit. Remember? Yeah, it was so windy.
It's actually going to be nice when we're there this time.
Yeah, it's going to be nice when we're there.
Yeah,
so
we can party whenever and however and as long as we want because it'll be nice and warmer.
Yeah.
Can't wait.
So I reached out. To her. But good. Yeah.
Now, if they got time, I'd love that place again. As long as they don't close us for $300 a night.
Yeah.
Because that could happen. If it's $300 a night, might as well get a stop at like a fucking hotel then if that's the case.
Oh, no. Hotels are going to be higher than that. They'll be sold out.
Probably. Maybe.
Yeah.
It always surprises me what ends up being available sometimes for busy weekends. But we'll see. So, but yeah, no, we'll be in town and we'll probably make our usual stops at McLean's and, we'll be trying to get into the draft itself, of course, and check things out from there. Because it's going to be a fucking interesting time for sure.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting for sure. Mm-hmm. I want to make a stop at Holder on McGill, though.
Holder on
McGill. If we can. Holder on McGill. The duck confit and the French onion soup.
Oh, okay.
So good there. So good there.
Yeah. That sounds like I got to make a stop at that one Subway I found was really good.
Oh, the one you went to the metal show?
Yeah, that was funny. At the Corona Theater. That was a nice tie-in to current times.
Yeah.
Never thought I'd care about that word as
Corona.
Much. Yep, the Corona Theater.
Nobody calls it that anymore, though.
I wonder, do they?
Like, I rarely hear coronavirus.
Oh, true. Yeah, either COVID and this and the other thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, well.
Oh, well. So, yeah, so that'll be fun.
It will be fun.
Yeah, get there on July 6th.
Yep, I'll be there as well. Getting Veronica from the airport.
Thank you.
Getting Beth at the airport at some point, too. Not entirely sure where she's when she's flying in.
Yep. I booked the time off work.
Yep.
And I got my flights entirely on points. I have a lot of points accumulated. And I'm flying first class both ways.
Mm-hmm.
Because I just thought, it's a 6-hour flight from Vancouver.
Why would you want to be with people?
You know, and so...
Why would you want to be with the menagerie in the back?
I mean, it's not so... Like, I don't mind flying economy, but I just thought, you know what? I have the points. Like, it cost me a grand total of $85 out of my pocket. For the tickets. So, you know what? I just, on the way there, actually, I wish it was on the way back, but on the way there, I have my own pod.
That's awesome. I want to do that sometime.
Yeah.
One of these days when I get my tax return, I'll probably go and try to do that to Vegas, but to Vegas, it's probably like more expensive for some reason. I don't know why, but oh well.
There's a nonstop from New York. No,
no,
it's not nonstop.
Not from Albany.
Oh, right.
Albany is a really weird airport when it comes to any destination that you want to go to. Because I think a one-way flight to... Wait a second. No, like, sorry, a there and back again would be like 500 and change to Vegas. It's weird. Seems expensive. Then
for a round trip? That yeah. sounds good.
500 American dollars.
American dollars, yeah.
To Canadian, that might be like $600 or $700,
mm-hmm.
give or take. Now, granted, yeah. So what I end up doing is I drive to fucking Hartford, Connecticut, you know, take a 2-hour drive out there, get a flight out of there and save $100 on that. Now, is it actually saving money if I have to pay for parking? Actually, yes, it is when it comes to the lots out there because right. or else like I could just get an Uber over to, you know, the yeah. airport over here.
Yeah.
But it's so, it's like, that's like the thing. Like I'm shopping around for airports in other fucking states to leave out of because they're like better priced. Same thing. Like I usually go down to JFK because JFK for some reason has cheaper prices than Albany. New York City airlines have cheaper prices than fucking Albany, New York. Albany, New York has 80,000 people on it. New York City, 10 million people mm-hmm. live there. It's like, what, how the mm-hmm. fuck does this happen?
That's weird.
I just don't understand.
Yeah. Maybe it's because more flights are leaving JFK.
Yeah. They call Albany the international airport mostly because they get freight. Assholes. Anyway, enough of that.
Anyway.
Because I could bitch about that all fucking day. Yeah. New season of Better Call Saul started yesterday.
Oh, man.
I didn't start it yet. I'm still running through season 3 at the moment of the series on my rewatch, preparing for the new season that's dropping now.
There is so much to unpack. So it was 2 episodes that aired last night.
Perfect.
Back to back. So it was like a 2.5-hour extravaganza with all the commercials and everything on AMC. Mm-hmm. But there is so much to unpack, Dave. I can't wait for you to watch it so we can talk about it. I listened to my friend Logan on Twitter. He's also a Better Call Saul huge fan. And he sent me the link to, because I know a lot of our listeners and a lot of Habs fans watch this show. But he sent me a link to a podcast this morning, which was basically an episode of like, huge Better Call Saul fans breaking down the first 2 episodes that aired last night. It is what it's called, the Watch Pod, and they do a lot of other TV shows as well, or other shows that are on either on Netflix or HBO or whatever. Oh, my allergies are kicking my ass. I'm so sorry. But this was fascinating. So listeners, if you can go to the Watch Pod, wherever you listen to your podcasts, if you're a Better Call Saul fan, the 2 people here reviewing it were like super huge, Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul junkies. And like, they know their shit. And they brought a couple of things up on there that I went, oh my God, I did not even realize that. So, I can't recommend that enough. I know that Dave, you're not big on listening to podcasts. You just host them.
Yeah. I just host one. I literally listen to 0 podcasts.
Yeah. Yeah. I listen to some sometimes. I listen to My Favorite Murder every week.
Oh yeah, if it's about murder.
Yeah, I love murder investigations. And everything that goes into them. But yeah, so anyway, Better Call Saul, worth it. There was so much that happened last night, and like I was thinking they're going to be like, they're going to start off slow and not give us anything. No, there was a lot in last night's episode. I'm not spoiling anything, but
awesome.
And yeah, directed by two different people, those two episodes.
Yeah. It's interesting who they pick for directors for these series. I wonder how that all breaks down.
Ray directs the fourth episode. She directs the fourth episode this season. That's cool. Yeah.
Nice. My girlfriend.
Yeah. Yes, your girlfriend. Yes. Your married girlfriend.
Great. My married girlfriend. Which everyone has at some point in their lives. Let's stop being coy about this, okay? It'll be a topic on next week's Habby Hour.
Yeah, she's great. And I didn't realize that this is really her first role. Like,
major role it is. Yeah. And she is fantastic.
She's fantastic.
She's incredible. Oh my God. And we're talking about Seahorn. That's right. Yeah. Also, kudos to Bob Odenkirk, who has himself a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. Much deserved. My God.
Oh, yeah. And Giancarlo Esposito, who plays Gus Fring.
Mm-hmm.
I saw him last night in an interview for the first time. Like, I've never seen him outside of his role in Better Call Saul or Breaking Bad. And He was on Jimmy Kimmel last night. Ugh. Oh my God, David. This guy, he's so high energy and fun.
That's solely not saying either.
It's completely, totally not Gus. I was so shocked.
That's
like
funny.
Laughs at his own jokes. He's really like smiling all the time and like super. He's like so the opposite of Gus. It's incredible.
That is really cool.
Yeah, it's really cool. So if you can find it on YouTube, he was on Jimmy Kimmel last night.
Awesome. Yeah, I'll have to check that out ASAP. Yeah. Oh, look at that. Habs post up some photos of Cornwallier speaking with Cole Caulfield. That's awesome. After the game.
Oh, nice. I think,
or during warmups, maybe. I'm not entirely sure. That's cool. And there's Dan Robertson that was on the call, tweeting as a reply, "This is great. What a thrill to have met Yvonne Cornwallier. Looking great at 78. Wow. And he does, too, because I remember meeting Yvonne during the fantasy camp. And, yeah, he was all over the place. He was great. Really great. Yeah. He was coaching the other team, essentially. Drawing up lines, talking to all the players about what they can do or not do. So that was pretty cool. Also, some very last-minute news. Adidas is being sued by a hockey fan in Florida for not actually selling authentic jerseys. The guy in the lawsuit cited that the stitching is wrong compared to auction bought jerseys that are worn on the ice and what's actually on sale by Adidas. One of the things about a jersey that makes it authentic, quote unquote, is that it's not the ironed on numbers, the cheap plastic numbers. It's the actually like sewed in numbers and whatnot, which is something I do check whenever I buy a jersey. I want to make sure that's actually sewed in. And I haven't had the issue that this particular person has had, but that's something to look out for, because I remember all my Reebok jerseys are authentic jerseys.
Yeah. I don't have an Adidas jersey. I don't think.
Are you sure? I think that Kotkaniemi has one.
No, it was a fake one.
Oh, okay.
I didn't know what I was buying. It was like one of those Fanatics ones.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it's kind of cheesy.
Whenever I get a jersey, I'm always like, money. And I get like a real one.
Yeah.
But I've also
I was just like, wow, I'm saving so much.
Yes.
And
yes.
It doesn't matter anyway, because he's gone.
Right. Yeah, right. But I remember like the last-ish jersey you got was like that one there.
It was.
There was something else to mention too. Oh, stop bothering Guy Lafleur.
Yeah.
Habs had to release a statement about that. That's embarrassing, fans. Leave him alone.
So I don't know to what degree they've been bothering him, but like, I don't know what's been going on, but.
Habs were like, there's going to be no more comment about this. It's like, oh, somebody did something somewhere. So.
Yeah.
Let's not do that anymore.
Yeah.
And then that's it. We are now out of time.
That's it. So it's too bad we didn't have fun Habs games to talk about.
Yeah, the last fun Habs game was against Jersey 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
It's cool, I guess.
And I miss it. I was at the gym.
2 wins in the last 10, give or take, I think, now for the Habs. Maybe 1 win, depending on how the games fall.
At this point, the only thing I'm looking forward to is the season being over.
Yeah, me too. Season over, done.
Sorry to say.
Ridiculous. And then, you know, we'll still be around in the summer, in the off season, chatting about whatever we can when we can.
As usual.
As usual. So, until then, like and subscribe. Thanks for listening. And we'll be back next week unless something catastrophic happens to our schedules again.
I think we'll be okay.
Yeah. Okay, bye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Get into town.